studies, with particular emphasis on the critical appreciation of dead and living horses in works of fiction, his work aims to introduce new and posthumanist ways of reading and understanding not only the literary, but also the actual human-animal relationships and entanglements. His Turkish translation of Donna Landry's Noble Brutes, How Eastern Horses Transformed English Culture, was published in 2015 with the title Asil Hayvanlar, İngiliz Kültürünü Değiştiren Doğulu Atlar. He also contributed to an upcoming collection of essays titled Equine Cultures, Horses, Human Society, and the Discourse of Modernity, 1700 to the present. Currently, he is working on a book project titled Dead Horse Matters, a study of equine agency through mortality in Victorian fiction. So please, Dr.
Faculty, dear students, good afternoon. I have to say it's a real pleasure and a true honor for me to be the first speaker of this exciting new series started by the Department of English Language and Literature here. I also, in my own humble way, would like to congratulate the administration here and the faculty here, because I think this will fill an important gap in our field in this country. Of course, there are many other colleagues who are doing cutting-edge research, but a series that focuses only on cutting-edge research, like the edges, is really valuable. And I hope to, and I look forward to be benefiting from the upcoming talks in the series. Okay, my title today is Horse-Human Entanglements in the English Novel of the Anthropocene. And if this puts you off a little bit, because by any chance you're not familiar with some of the terms here, like entanglement and anthropocene, please be relaxed. I'll do the best as I can to explain what these mean. And I'll also start with something I believe is quite familiar. Now, in his study of the origins of the novel, I'm obsessed with time, so Leonard Davis, in his book Factual Fictions in 1983, he said, "The gaunt figure of a man on a horse, out of place and out of time, seems to cast his shadow over any discussion of the European novel." Most probably is referenced to this Picasso drawing of Don Quixote, and we do know Don Quixote for representing a transition from the medieval chivalric romances into the more modern form of prose writing that we know today as a novel. But even though he didn't know, I think his emphasis on a man and a horse is full of potential for a post-humanist reading of not just the novel genre or different texts, but I think it's full of potential for a different angle on the rise of the novel debate as well. So based on that, I will actually dwell upon two main points today. One is the horses and the rise of the novel, in which eventually I will argue that if there were no horses, there would be no novel. Because of the dependence of the novel on horses in what I call the early Anthropocene, that is from about 1740s to 1850s, that's the early Anthropocene, from the beginnings of the Industrial Revolution until the time it had completely transformed Britain. And in the middle of this period, it's important to note that we have James Watt's invention of a working steam locomotive in 1784, which caused and started a process in which horses began to be replaced with both horsepower first and by iron horses, the steam locomotives as they came to be known by the end of the early Anthropocene. And this is also the period in which English novel rapidly grew into maturity. In Michael McKeon's words, in the works of Fielding and Richardson in the 1740s, the English novel comes to the end of its origins and begins to enter new territory. And I'll try to illustrate this idea with reference to Fielding's Joseph Andrews, Austen's Northanger Abbey, and Emily Bronte's Wuthering Heights, which were represent, like, as the historical period goes, the beginning, almost like the middle, and the end of this historical period that I call the early Anthropocene. After that, I'll dwell upon the breakthroughs of the Darwinian revolution, which reveal the ontological affinity and the continuities between the humans and animals, especially in his famous remark that we are different only in degree and not in kind. And based on that, some authors obviously reflected on the loss of a horse and how this loss could create ruptures in the narrative progression of their novels. And I'll also explain this with reference to the concept of narrative agency of Wildfire, that's the name of the horse, in George Eliot's Silas Marner, and Prince, another horse in Thomas Hardy's Tess of the D'Urbervilles. But the bottom line here is that I will argue horses, whether living or dead, were extremely powerful agents in the English novel of the 18th and the 19th centuries. But why horses? Because they had a place in human society and history that is unmatched by any other non-human animals. So we have a distinction between human animals and non-human animals. And because of that, they're also a useful focus for considering animal agency in literature, because the horse has occupied a central place in human imagination since the most primordial times, from the cave paintings on. As this critic puts it very recently, he said, the history of literature as a whole could be read as an attempt to define the role of the horse in human culture. I kind of agree with this, but obviously need some kind of periodization too. So this is why I'm interested in horses in the first place. And why dead horses? I know this sounds a little eerie, but to explain this, I also have to refer to the value encoded in living horses first, because even though industrialization changed everything, it actually caused an increase in the use of horses. In urban centers, they were used for local transport of goods and people, and in horse-drawn vehicles. They basically constituted, as Gina Dory remarks here, a part of the urban working classes, undernourished, overworked, and kept in damp, cramped, and squalid quarters. And in the rural countryside, they again continued both to perform agricultural labor and to be necessary for short-distance travel. Across English society, then, horses maintain significant use value despite the increased use of machines. And on that background, equine mortality was something, it was an event that one was very likely to witness in everyday life. As Hannah Veltan puts it, it only took 3 years in cities for cat horses to become exhausted if they hadn't already dropped dead in the streets. It was a very common sight. Again, in the countryside, it also remained a signifier of social status and prestige among the landed gentry, the aspiring middling ranks, and farmers, yeomen, and tradespeople, which caused an ascription of sign value, an exchange value to the horse. So even in the age of the iron horse, then the death of a flesh and blood horse meant a great loss, whether the horse in question was valued for its flesh, its muscle power, or for its bloodlines. And again, on that larger landscape, my main question is this: what happens if you look at works of literature as products of the interspecies dependence and entanglement of humans and non-human animals? And also take into account the roles of matter and semiosis in this production process as well. I'll try to address this question by first putting the Anthropocene context in dialogue with the rise of the novel debate, and then by adopting a critical position informed by quantum physicist philosopher Karen Barad's model called agental realism, and then in a more general sense, see literature as a plane on which the confusion and conflation of humans and animals take place. Now, the Anthropocene. It's a controversial term, still debated, But eventually it's officially recognized as a separate geological age, a new geological age defined by the profound and unprecedented impact of the Homo sapiens activity on our planet since the Industrial Revolution, as geologist Paul Crutzen and Stirner define it. And it literally means, according to Susan Rustick, age of humankind. But of course, in this debate, there's also a critique of this term because it is essentially anthropocentric, in other words, human-centered still. And she likens this to this 1903 portrait of Narcissus, where the pond itself does not exist for Narcissus. The trees in the sky about the pond do not exist. All that exists is the gazer enwrapped by his own image. That is still quite very anthropocentric, very selfish. Also, based on that, other critics argue that even though they too played a very central role in how the Anthropocene emerged, the role and place of animals has so far very little attention. And therefore, we need to start seeing this period in history as being co-authored by humans and animals, and the deep interspecies entanglements as one of its defining traits, as Thomas and Omar argue. Well, in my own way, I take this co-authoring analogy quite literally and argue that horses had a major role in the rise and maturation of the English novel as a distinct literary genre in the early Anthropocene. Now, of course, you may be wondering, is there still more to be said about the novel? I mean, Ian Watt talked about it, Walter Allen said his thing, we have Leonard Davis. Well, I say yes. Yes, there's more to be said about the novel. We can add to this debate if we acknowledge the agency of non-human animals and consider the functions of matter and semiosis as well, in an age when improved printing technologies cause an explosion of science in Britain. As Daniel Defoe himself put it in 1726, the printing art has outrun the pen and may pass for the greatest improvement of its kind in the world. So based on that, what really is a printed novel? Today, the recent material turn in the humanities is causing a change in the perception of printing as art and human progress or improvement. Robertson, for instance, recently considered print materials as marked surfaces that underwrite a social agreement. And his work is not self-reportedly informed by post-human theories, but it definitely corresponds to this concept of material discursivity in Karen Barad's A Gentle Realist Model, which I will explain shortly. In other words, this view illustrates a redefinition of print materials, such as a novel, as the human animal's discursive engagement, entanglement, and intraaction, as different from the interaction with matter, with the materials. Barad's A Gentle Realism and the term entanglement actually rejects any static and individual existence of, or pre-existence for that matter, and causality or agency. Everything is entangled. In her rejection of this essential separateness of word and thing, human and non-human, and discourse and matter, she proposes that we are interactively reconstituted constantly as part of the world's becoming, because we are only a part of that nature that we seek to understand. So we cannot really separate knowing from being. And on top of that, she also adds an ethical responsibility. In her model, A Gentle Realism, she suggests a fundamental inseparability of epistemological, ontological, and ethical considerations. And this inseparability offers an understanding of the role of human and non-human, material and discursive, and natural and cultural factors in scientific and other social material practices. And the term she uses for this is ethical ontoepistemology, which is not one word. Now, clearly, the term agency is central to my argument, and in addition to Barad's understanding of agency, my understanding is also informed by Bruno Latour's actor network theory, which attributes agency to anything that has an effect, whether inanimate agency is in fact the ability to have an effect. Now, to translate this to animal agency, I'll refer to Richie Nimmo's work, who believes that animal agency and animal being are not different from each other. And in this understanding, as Carter and Charles put it, agency is no longer simply a matter of reflexive and intentional action conceived in terms of a duality with some notion of structure, but it's more about the multiple and dispersed effects of a certain mode of being in the world upon other elements in a heterogeneous network or assemblage, less about active behavior and more about relational existence. And this relational existence basically is the entanglement of the horse and human in my own case. And there's also enough grounds to attribute agency to horses, not only in human society, but also in the material discursive practices, such as novels produced by the human animal. Now, my second strand of argument goes, of course, on the importance of semiosis. The rise of the novel in the early Anthropocene was also a result of the intensively semioactive environment, as I would like to call it, just like radioactivity, semioactivity, of the early Anthropocene, when human semiosis in Britain reached unprecedented levels. Of course, there were print materials before, but with mechanical production and many other factors coming together, there was an explosion of science, posters, all kinds of print materials everywhere. And this semioactivity was enabled, of course, to a great extent with the increased availability and affordability of the materials necessary for printing. And from within this semioactive environment, what I call the semantic humanimal, in this case, the English novelist of the early Anthropocene, was born. The term humanimal belongs to Pramod Nayar, but I built upon it to apply it to the act of producing material discursive entities by using semiotic systems. And I define the semantic humanimal as an extraordinary human animal who, in her or his conscious or unconscious entanglement, interacts with the world not only gesturally, but also agentically through semiosis, through all kinds of signs, whether grammatical or not, by way of discursively and onto-epistemologically inscribing them on matter by using the necessary tools such as pen, paper, ink, paint, etc., and through the performance of her bodily extensions, hands, fingers, which allows me to say that these semantic humanimals in this historical period frequently interacted both with the semiotic sign of the horse and the flush and the flesh and blood horse, and in turn they responded by assigning considerable amount of labor on the equine species in long prose narratives that depicted long sections of the lives of human characters who were in constant mobility, basically encountering or undertaking adventures. In due time, these narratives came to be known as novels, as different from histories. I'll try to illustrate this with reference to Joseph Andrews, to this particular traveling method explained by the narrator as ride and time. Remember how Parson Adams and Joseph Andrews, they travel, but they only have one horse to share. And the narrator explains this method as follows. The two travelers set out together on horseback, the other on foot. Now, as it generally happens that he on horseback outgoes him on foot, the custom is that when he arrives at the distance agreed on, he is to dismount, tie the horse to some gate, tree, post, or other thing, and then proceed on foot. When the other comes up to the horse, he unties him, mounts, and gallops on, till having passed by his fellow traveler, he likewise arrives at the place of tying. Now, the example of the horse-human entanglement in this particular case is that the main events and revelations that drive the plot forward take place during the intervals when the two characters are physically distant from one another, because they've been riding and tying. But also they take turns riding and tying not only the horse, but also the episodes of the story. basically building, was replicating and even simulating a particular form of the horse-human relationship as he organized the narrative and the physical space of the paper he was using. If you remember from the preface, he explains why there are episodes, why some pages are like full until only the middle of the page and the rest is blank. He explains these are the resting spots in the reading experience as they arrive in time, the horse and the story as well. Now, my second example is Jane Austen, who we know to be an icon of Englishness for representing the 19th century landed gentry class, to which she herself belonged. And I'm so much so that there's some document about how shell-shocked soldiers in the First World War were recommended to read Jane Austen's novels, you know, to ease their feelings of homesickness and actually see and experience that bit of England when they were away from their homes. I actually see Jane Austen here as a semantic humanimal who used the typically English act of novel writing to create simulacra of Englishness. In fact, as we all know, she herself became one such simulacrum of middle-class Englishness in due course by depicting a patriotic Pride and Prejudice. I cannot really go into the details of this, but there is there. In her Gothic parody, Northanger Abbey, she established the image of the English gentleman as opposed to the countries, you know, of the Catholic countries of French and Italy during her criticism of the Gothic genre. She establishes the image of the English gentleman traversing the countryside on the back of fine horses after the land enclosures of the 18th century. The obvious example is the character John Thorpe in this novel, who, in order to impress Catherine Morland, the protagonist of this story, he boasts about his horses. "Do but look at my horse. Did you ever see an animal so made for speed in your life? Such true blood." Thorpe's confidence in his horse is such that he even measures distances by the speed of his horse. And when Catherine's brother rejects his calculation and says, you know, this is wrong, he protests. He says, "But look at his forehead," because the phenotypical qualities of the horse. "Look at his loins. Only see how he moves. That horse cannot go less than 10 miles an hour. Tie his legs and he will get on." Now, obviously, England's countryside gentry understood fine horse flesh and made it a symbol of thoroughbred Englishness. A very popular example of which is this painting titled "Whistle Jacket" by George Stubbs in 1762. And if you go to the National Gallery in London, this is a life-size portrait, which is quite impressive. And as Donna Landry explains, this "Whistle Jacket" became a national icon, perpetually among the top 10 most popular reproduced images at the National Gallery, emblematizing a shared national culture. Well, in fact, like about one-fourth of the souvenir shop is "Whistle Jacket." So based on that semiotic association of representing a shared national culture and thoroughbred Englishness, at one point during my studies, I was able to argue that Jane Austen was a horse. No one really objected. My other example is Wuthering Heights, but I thought we'd first take a look at the relationship between Bronte sisters and animals. In this exhibition called "The Brontes and Animals" that was held at the Parsonage Museum there in 2015, I was able to get a hold of the documents and banners from them through personal correspondence. And one of the banners says they used animals in their novels as a device to reveal personalities, this is important, and for developing relationships between characters, as well as to drive the plot forward. Now, the curator of the museum, I asked her this question, like, did she have any horses or any ponies? Did the family own any? She said, no, they didn't own any horses or ponies. And then she even also told me that Emily's favorite, in fact, was a pet dog named Keeper. But then she referred me to the local historian of Howard Township, who kindly provided these documents for me. And it looks like there were 91 horses of various sizes recorded in the tax documents of 1831 in Howard Township. And about half of these horses, 42 in total, were ponies. And these ponies were of a specific breed known as the Galloway, a pony breed of Scotland and Northern England that was, as defined, a strong, multi-purpose black or bay horse with a significantly long mane. Now this image is again quite relevant. And again, this other visual is from that area and from that historical period, which in fact clearly showed that Emily saw these Galloways doing labor on a daily basis, even the family did not own any horses or ponies, and responded by assigning an immense amount of narrative labor. The most obvious example for me being Dr. Cathy's arrival, first arrival at Heathcliff's residence, which is on the back of Minnie, who is expressly described as a Galloway. And if you remember the two houses and the moors between the two houses, all of the action really takes place and is enabled by characters moving back and forth between Wuthering Heights and the Thrushcross Grange. And it's always on the back of these ponies. Without them, they wouldn't really be able to, you know, create that kind of action. But it also, these ponies also influenced, obviously, Emily's imagination of Heathcliff, because it's on the back of such a handsome black pony that Cathy's mother, Catherine Earnshaw, returns from the Lintons after her transformative stay with them, which is in fact also perpetrated by a dog, because they're trying to escape and the dog bites and she has to stay there. That is another example of animal agency in the narrative. And that return is to a Heathcliff who was soon afterward insulted by Edgar Linton, who likens his walk as to a colt's mane over his eyes, just like a Galloway. And he soon disappears after overhearing some conversation and returns eventually to Wuthering Heights, dressed in dark clothes, with dark face and hair, and as an unreclaimed creature without refinement. And this is the quality of ponies, as different from horses. They are unreclaimed creatures. They're a little more, you know, mischievous creatures than horses. So here are some Heathcliffs and a Galloway from some film adaptations and some drawing. And this is basically how I argued, like, the imagination of this character was influenced by the Galloway pony. And again, on that association, this time, I kind of really easily feel that Emily Bronte was a pony, a Galloway pony. Now, the second section of my presentation here is about the agency of the dead horse, and my understanding of the agency of the dead horse is in fact informed by Jacques Derrida's engagement with a question the utilitarian philosopher Jeremy Bentham asked in 1823 about the nature of animal subjectivity, or about the question of sentience. What is a sentient creature? He said, the question that we should ask is not, as Descartes did, can they reason? Or it should not be, can they talk? Because the Enlightenment philosophy defined human for his abilities of thinking and speech. But he says, the question we need is, can they suffer? And in his own interpretation of this idea, Derrida suggests that mortality is the most radical means of thinking, the finitude that we share with animals, it's the mortality that belongs to the very finitude of life, to the experience of compassion. And coming from that, I, in my own context, suggest a reformulation of the Cartesian idea, this logocentric cogito ergo sum, as morior ergo sum, I die, therefore I am, which I believe is more to the point philosophically. Because at this point, in our debates about environmental issues and animal rights and everything, we are, I believe, in need of developing a notion of animal mortality, including the human animal, rather than being tied to the evidently limited notion of human morality to understand and acknowledge the agency of animals, both human and non-human. It's this ethico-epistemological sensibility. It's in the understanding of death through the death of another that emerges. And I believe George Eliot and Thomas Hardy, they had a deep understanding of this. They had the sensibility and had a deep understanding of the value of horses, not only through their observations of everyday life, but also given their awareness of the scientific and philosophical debates about the origin, evolution, and entanglement of all organic beings. Now, to illustrate, I'll first go to George Eliot's Silas Marner, the conventional reading of which will tell us that the novel's overt focus is on the reconciliation of Silas, a secluded weaver obsessed with hoarding and counting the gold that he earns from his trade, with the countryside community of Rallo. And then his appeasement with life and the society begins when he adopts a baby girl, Epi. And his initial motivation for adopting Epi is the expectation that he will be compensated for the loss of gold stolen from him a few weeks earlier. And this, in this conventional reading, is the most visible climax in the novel. The golden-haired infant, Epi, miraculously replaces the lost gold with human connection. It's almost like a fairy tale element in this novel. But when we look carefully at the plot to see what comes of Silas's loss of his gold, we encounter the death of a fine horse. And that is, in fact, the main problem, the death of Wildfire. Described as a valuable hunter, a hunting horse owned by Godfrey Cass. Wildfire turns out to be the only means by which Godfrey can regain the rent money that he had collected from a tenant for his father, Squire Cass, but which has been spent by his younger brother, Dunstan, drinking and gambling. And eventually, to skip all the details, Dunstan suggests that Godfrey sell his horse, and he eventually agrees. There's no other way to, you know, regain that money. So the arrangement is that Dunstan takes the horse, takes Wildfire to the marketplace and to negotiate for a good price. And on his way, he enjoyed the self-important consciousness of having a horse to sell and the opportunity of driving a bargain. And this enjoyment is basically coming from appearing as the owner of a commodity with considerable prestige and exchange value. And as the narrator puts it, Dunstan's horse dealing, one of many human transactions carried in this ingenious manner, ends with this character Bryce's purchase of the horse for 120, to be paid on the delivery of Wildfire, safe and sound, at the Baderly stables. Now, of course, something's bound to happen at that point, and it's because instead of taking the horse to Baderly at once, he's overcome by the inclination for a run, especially with a horse under him that will take the fences to the admiration of the field, the sign value of this fine flesh and blood horse, fine blood horse. And I think this is perhaps the most climactic moment in the novel, because Dunstan takes one fence too many and stakes the horse. As the narrator puts, his own ill-favored person, which was quite unmarketable, So this is like a privileging of the non-human character over the human character through these adjectives. Escaped without injury, but poor wildfire, unconscious of his price, turned on his flank, and painfully panted his last. And this is the illustration from the model. Now, I believe that the death of Wildfire, in fact, starts a wildfire in the narrative, which cannot be controlled by the human characters, not even by the narrator, because this was the loss of the only opportunity to find the money. Dunstan goes to Silas's cottage and steals his gold, and eventually, and thereby connecting the novel's two subplots. And we have everything changing from that moment on. So this entanglement of the two subplots as an effect of the death of Wildfire is the very point at which I think Eliot's ethical epistemological sensibility really takes off. When that horse becomes powerfully agential, both in the narrative and in an entangled world of human and non-human beings. And I think also that the stake that pierces Wildfire's body, in fact, also pierces through the narrative of a novel that initially seems to be exclusively focused on the experiences of human characters. And my last example and last text is Thomas Hardy's Pest. But again, it's useful to look at how he perceives all the animals, because we basically know him as a naturalist or was influenced by a naturalist movement. But he represents a wholly different stylistic and philosophical approach to animals and their relationships to mankind, as this critic puts it. We do also know that he was quite familiar with the works of Charles Darwin, and for that reason he had an organicist, an integrated perspective in which describing an animal becomes the same technical problem as drawing a human being. And in his novels, this awareness takes shape in representations of death and suffering. And this also comes from a childhood memory from a very early age where he witnessed the killing of a field hare, and that stayed with him all his life. The horse-human entanglement in Tess is, of course, to be seen when we look at the plot of the novel, which relies heavily on the use value of a horse and the loss of this value when this horse dies. Thus, this tragedy, which includes rape, loss of her infant child, abandonment by her husband, and eventually execution by hanging, all begin with the death of Prince, a weak wagon horse. Although he has little actual exchange value and no sign value at all, just a rigid cart horse, Prince's labor is necessary for the subsistence of this large peasant family. So it's Prince's blood that causes everything, because when her father is too drunk upon news of some connection to some ancient noble family, he loses himself, is drunk, and he's supposed to take some beehives to the market the next day, but only Tess is available to do that now. So at about 1:30 in the morning, she goes out to the stable to harness Prince, who looked wonderingly around as if he could not believe that at that hour he was called out and called upon to go out and do labor. He's a laborer. And then she takes off, growing drowsy during the ride. She falls asleep, the cart moves on to the wrong lane, and only to be awakened by a hollow groan, unlike anything she had ever heard in her life, that proceeded from her father's poor horse, Prince. And she immediately discovers that the horse has been badly injured by the pointed shaft of the speeding morning mail cart that pierces him like a sword. Prince staggers, his life's blood spouting in a stream. Now, the pointed shaft here is, again, it pierces just like the stake in Silas Marner. It pierces through not just horse's flesh, but through the narrative to change everything. And it's like a sword, referring also to the theme of nobility and all these news about the noble knights of the past that the D'Urberville's family comes from. And the entire tragedy is symbolically manifest here in both the blood pool that was still visible in the middle of the road. Like the conventional readings of this is like there's also blood in her dress, and the most simple reading of this is that this is foreshadowing of her upcoming rape by Alec. And no, but this is way beyond that, because it's also related to princely blood, the theme of heredity, or bloodlines in this case, which is an essential part of the plot, so much so that I think it's possible to describe this novel as a novel about blood. Because in imagining Tess's tragedy, Hardy seems to have expanded Darwin's understanding of different characters or different beings coming from the same great natural class, and written from a larger Darwinian idea of interconnectedness of all species, in his own way of confusing and conflating the tragedies of human and horse. In the novel, the economic or use value of animals, first and foremost, the horse, of course, prints, they get refracted back on the human characters, particularly Tess. Eventually she has to die too. Just like Dunstan himself, Dunstan also dies in a pit. You kill a horse, you die. Now, eventually my conclusions, good timings. The English novel, I say, grew into maturity within the semi-activity of the early Anthropocene. And the semantic animals who were born there, they lived in an age when beliefs about the human's place and role in nature were also beginning to be replaced with a new understanding based on interconnectedness. And these human animals also responded to the horse through ethico-epistemological interaction. And they grafted their performance of this response on matter, on paper, using ink and anything else, by writing novels. And the other obvious conclusion is that horses were literally everywhere, not only in the streets or on the fields, but also in the names of the machinery that was ultimately to replace them. Horses were everywhere, again, in the English novel, in its formative centuries, carrying load, carrying narratives, carrying people, jumping fences, and for galloping, miles on end. We failed to see for a very long time, but they were, and they are, always there, somewhere. It's like my tattoos would say. So thank you very much. And this picture here is to not to suggest that I'm being narcissistic, but to say that in order to be a really engaging animals or literary animals, one really has to touch the animal. Animal studies is not something that can be really attempted by reading theory only, or sitting in your offices, or at your desks, or living in your dorm rooms. Because I keep warning my students about this. They are attracted to this, but you know, without touching the animal, it's not complete. All right. Thank you very much. Well, I mean, there are different positions on that. I'm not a vegetarian.
I'm sorry, I couldn't resist. I wonder if there are any questions or comments for us.
Yeah, I'm very happy to address any possible questions or comments or feedback or new challenging ideas. I'll be really, really happy to hear you. How I decided to
study about horses in novels, for example. Is it from your class or?
ask me the same question. What is the reason for this interest in the horse? Obviously, I loved them all my life, but then I was never asked this question, and upon the question, I began to remember. And just like, I think it's like Hardy's experience, it comes from a very old childhood memory, where I was kind of stuck in between a wild horse or a runaway horse in the field. As I was traveling to the fields with my grandpa on his cart, right, horse drawn cart wagon. And I think that is the reason. But then, of course, my justification for that is not just personal. They are everywhere. Like the next time you read a novel, try to look at the animals, try to see the horse. They are everywhere.
I have a small question.
If Jane Austen was a horse and Emily Bronte was a pony, what's Tom Sardi? And George Eliot too.
Well, I didn't really think about it, but I would say dead horses.
Dead horses.
No, I mean, the title of my book project is Dead Horse Matters, and I think there are at least two or three layers of meaning to that. Because dead horse, you know, as an expression means things that are irrelevant right now. You know, I mean, they're dead horses, we should be looking at them. But what I do in my book is to go back and as Donna Haraway would put it, Donna Haraway is a famous name in post-humanist studies, even though she says I'm not a post-humanist. She, in order to understand and the animals with a new perspective, she offers this term respect, which she explains comes from the Latin root respecere, meaning to look again. But this time, to really see, to really understand, to really respect, to admire. So I thought I would look back on these novels one more time and to see something else, to see the horses, not the human characters. So if I do that, I would say, very, I mean, that's an easy answer for now. I'll think about it though. They were again the horses.
Evaluation on the difference between poetry and fiction too, because in poetry there are many, many poems written about animals, where the animal is really the agent. It's obvious, like Coleridge's *Rigsby Ryan of the Ancient Mariner* or Tatew's poems. But in the case of a novel, they appear as very, very minor characters, right? in the traditional sense of reading.
Yes.
So what you're trying to do is to foreground that and to make us see that the novel is not all about human beings.
It definitely is not.
Characters, but mm-hmm. You know, these are also characters. So you're also making a distinction here between the two genres.
That's a very good question, Ozan, and thank you very much for asking this. Let me first start by saying that it's not only about the novel genre.
Yeah.
Like, it's a larger comment, basically, on what the literature is. Well, you know, sitting down, using these materials to scratch something on a piece of paper really is just like Emily Dickinson did. Like, she was an animal. Emily Bronte, she was an animal, a different animal of her own. And poetry, basically, is something quite else. And I was telling to our colleague here before the talk, there's this brilliant work by Aaron Moe, and the title of his book is Zoo Poetics, where he explains all instances of writing a poem as an act of animality. And how animals also write poetry, because poesis means to make, and they all make something. They all tell a story in verse. But then, in my own understanding. study of literary animals as it's practiced right now is to see the animal for itself, not as a symbol, not as a metaphor, not as a stand-in for human, not as, you know, as a literary device, but see the animal for what it really is. See the horse as a horse, and see what it does. Yeah, thank you very much. I'm not sure if this is an answer, but yes, poetry is definitely quite relevant, and maybe even more full of potential.
More obvious.
Yeah.
Very tiny detail, perhaps, but you mentioned that this term, iron horse, was used for locomotives in the 19th century.
Yeah, I think about 1814, it was...
Everyone understood what it is. It's being used to represent bicycles nowadays, and because they resemble the, you know, the shape of a horse. And another interesting point is that human beings are using their bicycles for carrying themselves, for carrying their loads, and for some economic activities as well. And sometimes they treat them like little creatures. Just like horses, and perhaps this shows the value of bicycles as well as the value of horses, because we are in a way finding ourselves entangled with our bicycles as well as with our horses.
Exactly, John. Yes, this is also a very good point, because another strand of post-human studies is now interested in objects, in things, and bicycles, they too have lives.
Cars.
And cars, and I was going to make that point about how, like, the last ASLE conference was held in Detroit, where I was lucky enough to visit the Henry Ford Museum, where the earlier cars and the train wagons are on display. And I was kind of not really surprised, but intrigued by the fact that the earlier car designs were based on the design of the horse-drawn wagons. So the cars, the shape of the car that we have today is an extension, is a continuation of that horse-human relationship. The train wagons that we have today, they were shaped by the first objective embodiments of the horse-human relationship. It wasn't to say something else about the post-humanist interactions between the horse and the human, where in Richard III we have a horse, my kingdom for a horse in Shakespeare's work. Maybe he was the first post-humanist because his horse is dead, and it now suddenly occurs to him that, oh, the loss of a horse is, you know, it's bummer. You know, it's a deal. It's such a big deal.
It's just a very small gift from our department. Maybe you can use it when you're writing.
Thank you very much.
I don't know.